they believe in Big Bang, which is a stolen concept, and they think that Big Bang is the birth of the entire cosmos. It is not. Because when they say this Big Bang, which was a very compressed ball of matter and which has exploded itself and created time, space and everything, where did this matter came from? Where did, and if you say at time t equal to zero this took place, so what happened at t equal to minus one? So what was this matter before? So these are, this I call as scientific mythology. When they call Hindu mythology, like whatever we tell them, they call Hindu mythology, which is very scientific, and they call it something they create. Okay, time got created somehow. So this is scientific mythology. They are unable to explain this. What is spirituality? Why do people do meditation? So I got into researching more on this subject and keep delving into the depths of this subject. So we will be covering these topics under the following heads. What is in a name? Why name is so important? Then thereafter covering why universe is called universe, gravity, black hole, and thereafter I'll take on all the questions you may have. The word name may have come from Sanskrit word nama, in the behalf of or by the authority of. It was used in invocations by late 14th century. Name day is called the day sacred to the saint whose name a person bears, say Augustine or any other, Saint Paul. So the name day used to be celebrated. It was for the respect of that person. And it also, in Old English, it was called Nama or Noma. It denoted name or reputation. And Proto-Germanic Naman, Latin Nomen, and Proto-Indo-European root Naman. But all of you must be wondering, can we just fix names? Like all of us can agree to call something and we can accept. What happens if we do that? We and all know that in Sanskrit and Hindi, we use the word Sangya. Sangya means by attaching which we have knowledge of an object. Subject, suppose if we call arm or mango, we have a picture of mango appearing in our brain. So we have to attach word to an object to gain knowledge of it. The name should create an automatic impression in our minds by presenting itself, one of its rupa, appearance, qualities, bhava, force, or dharma, properties, etc. So if the name is correct and we will be able to gain the knowledge of that object clearly, that attribute of that object will be clear. And one object may have many, many words for its description. Say you have Vishnu Sahasranama. So 1,000 names are able to describe one person or one divinity. So how do these misnomers, if you use misnomers, how do they affect us? Natural language is coded in our brains. This language is called Parapashyanti, Madhyama and Vakshri or Vakri. It flows from one medium to the other medium, from the subtle medium to the more coarse medium. I will explain you. For example, whatever I am speaking to you, it is the words I am speaking, and you are able to hear these words and decipher them in your brain. Whatever in my brain is always coded into a pictographic memory. Scientists know they can read the mind, they can download the pictographic memory. Our brain processes everything in pictographs. Our past life information is also coded in our brain as a pictographs. All the memory information is coded as picture memory in our brain. From that, we convert it into Madhyama, what we think and then what we speak, the language which is in between, the language in which we think. Language is the machine language of our brain. How much throat should be contracted, how much lips should be moved, it is automatically done by our brain. The wrong words, if we use, then it affects the conceptualization of our mind. The language is the only thing which is carrier of knowledge. It is medium of creation and medium of preservation of intelligence. The naming should be pure for better conceptualization. The word universe, as we think of it, it affected me. I came to know why it is known as universe. So I decided what is so good about this word, that it is representing the entire existence. In 1580s, the word originated from the old French universe and from the Latin word universum, which meant all things, everybody, all people, the whole world literally turned into one. And from unus, the word uni came, which was meaning one. So hypothetically, it was also existed in Greek. The word for uni is onios and unus and avam in old Persian language. Whereas the verse comes from, it is like line or section of a psalm or canticle. If you write a poem, one of the lines or four lines of a poem is a verse. In the line of poetry, it is commonly used. It is used in French also. And Latin, it is called versus. And it means basically a rhythm, a poetic stanza, which means verse. So universe is one stanza, but how does it affect? What is the literal meaning? How does it represent the universe? Shri Krishna in Gita chapter 15 verse 1, he mentions the cosmos is like a tree whose roots are on top and branches are downwards, and the verses are the leaves of this tree. The one who understands this aspect of universe is knowledgeable. What it means, what is written in Sanskrit, Urdhu Moolam Madhya Shakham Stvam Prahurvyam Chandasi Yasya Pranani Yastam Veda Sa Vedvita. Yastam Veda Sa Vedvita means who knows this is knowledgeable. Chandasi Yasya Pranani means the stanzas are the leaves of that tree. This tree, this is a visualization in which, like, this is the extension of that visualization which Shri Krishna said, that every leaf is a canticle, a poem. So if I see picture of universe, impose it on this tree and make it inverted, so what comes to my mind is the individual galaxies which are there. They are like leaves. If you take this tree as a big tree, people tree or a banyan tree, you will find so many leaves are there. And so many leaves are represented by so many galaxies in this universe. Now you see this picture and try to listen to it. This video is recorded by NASA Hubble. If you go onto your phone, Instagram app, type NASA Hubble, you will find in their galleries. What happens is Hubble telescope records the visual as well as radio signatures of galaxies, and they give the visual and radio signatures equivalent sound frequency and audio frequency. Since you are all aware, all waves are act in a similar fashion. They follow the same laws of physics, whether they are mechanical sound waves or the electromagnetic waves. most of their characteristics are same. So just to get the waves into the human ear, we have to give them a frequency, assign them a frequency. But as this ray is scanning this galaxy, a music is being heard. This music is the is that a particular chand. This is that verse which is being described. Basically, it means this music is able to represent a galaxy. How this music represents a galaxy, I will, in detail, I will cover sometime. Whereas, if there are many verses, like many galaxies together, they are being scanned by this telescope and you are able to hear this music, it makes more sense. The word universe only represents one of the world, which is Milky Way galaxy. And it's not small, it is very big. So the universe, as I said, it is one leaf, it is one verse. It only indicates one galaxy, our galaxy, which is Akashganga or Milky Way galaxy. Whereas the correct terminology for the entire the setup will be, could be a multiverse. It could be Brahmand, it could be Brahm, Jagat, or Cosmos. It could be a better word for it. Now, coming to two words which I use. One is Jagat and one is Sansara. What Sri Krishna said and what I am saying, the person who knows the difference between Jagat and Sansara, he is Vedvita, he is a knowledgeable person. Because Jagat, the word itself defines. Jai gayate. Jai means gyan. Gay means gam dhatu. This is movement. And te is beingness. Tatu. What is in tat? Or it represents the moving knowledge which creates itself. It is a property of creation. And sansara. Sansara is not same as Jagat. Jagat is, would be a physical universe or physical cosmos. Whereas samsara is what we understand by outside whatever inputs our mind takes and we take a conclusion out of it. It is called sara. So when everybody is thinking about this universe and they have their own world within their mind, there are as many people, as many interpreters, there are as many minds. But when they interpret this and reflect, sansara means like it is a sara, it is conclusion. Samsara means together this conclusion. Like every human being, the interpretive mind, they will interpret the Jagat and they will have a particular conclusion about this Jagat in their minds. And when we together, like every mind is thinking and we are projecting this thinking into the Brahm itself, and we together are able to pick up each other's brain waves, we are able to pick up each other's opinions, and we are able to create we are able to contribute to the Brahm and creativity of the Brahm. So this is the interpretive part is samsara, whereas the physical existence part is Jagat. Now, also how the universe is created. We all know that we have been given this concept of Big Bang. It has been told that there was a Big Bang and then the universe, entire universe formed itself. So this, I have written a paper about this also. This is not the correct explanation. Actually, in Brahmand Purana, this concept has been written that this was a golden womb or golden egg. From this golden womb or golden egg, Brahma created heavens and earth. From the upper part, he made Dyu Loka and Bhu Loka from the lower part. And it was about correct. It is also about creation of Milky Way. The Milky Way, the way it has been formed up from the central black hole, which is Sagittarius A star, and it is not about the cosmos. And this is the shloka which got me interested in doing entire research about the physics or the cosmology. This is Tat Sharva Shakti Bij Jad Prakriti Vasna Vasnaya Vyakt Bhava Pranav Shabda Dikkal Ano Api Tasya Rupani. The omnipotent source or the seed has created nature with expressed force of will, which is Vasnaya Vyakt Bhava. Om, the Pranav Shabda transforms in space, time and matter. This is how it has progressed in a slower fashion, not about in a big bang, but in as a small whim for it has started. When you see Dik Kal, Dik means directions or the space, and Kal means time. Ano api means the entire universe was created by a principle which is called principle of Mahat. Mahat means from small, how the things grow big as a principle. And anu is means subtleness or smallness, whereas Mahat means big and bigger. Now coming to the second word, which is Gurutva. As the modern science knows, Sir Isaac Newton, in 1687, he presented the inverse square law of gravitation in his Philosophiae Naturalis Principia Mathematica. And the world, as it seems, they act as an authentication seal and they point to source of the knowledge. And it has also been conveyed by Professor C.K. Raju that Indian calculus, how it traveled to Europe and how it was expressed by Newton and Leibniz by their own invention. Whereas the word gravity, it comes from the Latin word gravitas or from gravis, which means heavy, and which in turn comes from still more ancient root word thought to have existed because of numerous cognates in the related languages. The Sanskrit word which is equivalent is like gurutva, like gravity. So these words have common meaning of heaviness, importance, seriousness, dignity, grimness, etc. And if we now scientists have been able to see that, have we been measuring gravity this whole time, they are now doing more research about gravity, whether Newton was right or whether he was just influenced by an idea and he represented it in a better manner mathematically. In Kanad Rishi, which is pre Mahabharata, Kanad Rishi was ancient Rishi, and he has written Vaisheshika Sutra. If I go by the word Vaisheshika, it means special knowledge and basically scientific sutras which are there. These sutras are actually, they do not describe much. They only describe the principles. If you know the principles, you can arrive at anything. So, Gurutva Prayatna Sanyog Sanyoganam Ut Akshepanam. That means Ut Akshepanam means throwing upwards is due to the conjunction or resultant of the force and gravity, or it results in falling of that object. Sanyog Abhave Gurutvat Patnam. If there is absence of conjunction, there is no Sanyoga. Sanyoga means combination of forces. Then falling results from results due to gravity. Sanskar Abhave Gurutvat Patnam. Absence of efficacy of previous resultant actions, the arrow falls. It is how does the arrow fall is described. So this entire Vaisheshika Sutra I have studied myself, and I was surprised. I was so surprised that I from the beginning to end I read and I translated them, and I represented a chapter in my book. How the modern dimensions, like you say 3D, three-dimensional or 4D, including time, how incorrect concept which has resulted and with incorrect understanding of science. Apam sanyog abhave gurutvat patnam. In the absence of conjunction of all the forces, the waterfalls due to gravity. It has been so clearly written. So the question is there gravity in space? The gravity is there in space, but it is a very weak force. It is a force which is like a planet, which extends to the people living on it or the objects living nearby. Whereas in the space, there are other forces. The other forces, one of them is like, I will explain this concept to you first. You see, there is a nucleus around which the electron revolves. If you see the bigger picture of this, the sun is in the center and around which the smaller planets revolve. If you see even bigger picture of this, you will find there is a central black hole in the center of every galaxy. And there are many stars which revolve around that central black hole. So in the center of our galaxy, there is a black hole which is known as Sagittarius A star. And its mass is 400 million times the mass of the sun. So around that, all the solar systems revolve. And similarly, if you extend it further, there is a bigger force, center of the force, which is in the center of the cosmos and around which all the galaxies revolve. So this shloka, which is written, Udu Siriya Ushno Rochmana Asturapam Normayo Rushante Karnoti Vishwasupata Suganya Budu Vasvi Dakshina Maugini. The radiant dawn have risen up for glory in their white splendor like the waves of water. She makes path all easy, fair to travel and rich, has shown herself benign and friendly. This shloka is from Rig Veda. This describes how the rays of sun, they travel and they make the space-time continuum friendly for traveling all planets around it. Hirne api suvita vicharsh anubhe dava prithvi antriyate apamiva vadate veti suryam abhi krishnen radsa dramranoti. Golden-headed, all beholding Savita. This Savita is spread between the two regions of heaven and earth, dispels the pain, brings the sun and overspreads the sky with control and radiance, destroying darkness. This Savita originates from the central black hole, which we know as Savitur. If you are aware, what is the Gayatri Mantra? Om Bhur Bhava Svah Tat Savitur Varenyam Bhargo Devasya Dhimahi Dhyo Yone Prachodayat. So, Tat Savitur Varenyam, if you recognize these words, have you ever thought who the Savitur is? That Savitur who is worshipable, Varenyam, who gives war to everyone. So, do you know who is this worshipable Savitur? This worshipable Savitur is none other than the Sagittur. It is known as Sagittur and Sagittarius constellation, which is there in the central of Milky Way. This is known as Sagittarius A star, which is a seat of Brahma. So, what happens is, Brahma has, for every galaxy, there is a Brahma. There are many Brahmas for all galaxies, and there is a Mahabrahma who controls the central space. Whereas the Brahma for each galaxy controls whatever happens in his galaxy. He is in charge of creation. He has been made to do everything. It is his intelligence in this galaxy. So, from the central black hole, every star is controlled. From the star, every solar system is controlled. From the planet, everything around that planet is controlled. These are the forces which are spread in the universe. And a resultant force of these forces, which is existing, has been calculated as capital G, which is representing gravity in modern science. Similarly, another shloka, Suvita Yantre Prithvi Marmanad Skam Bane Suvita Dam Dradant Ashmiva Du Akshadun Nimanti antriksh martute badham suvita samudram. This makes it more clear. Suvita has fixed the earth with fetters, like the wheel is fixed around the axle. Suvita has made the heaven form in a plural place where there was no sport. Suvita has milked the cloud of firmament bound to the indestructible ether like a trembling horse. It means all the objects in this Milky Way would have run away like trembling horse if the Suvita was not withholding their reins. Means they, it is controlling. There is another force which I have come to know, which is known as Bhaga. Bhaga means Bhai and Gai. Bhai means light and Gai means Gachha Dhatu, Gam Dhatu, means movement of light which controls. It is a controlling force in the cosmos. It is Bhagwan who is preserver of the cosmos. He runs the show in which he influences the, his mechanism through other divine beings. The word Bhag, as I told you, it means movement of light. In the cosmological sequence of evolution, the unseen energy which reaches a state where it becomes forever in both ways, space and time, it is mentioned in Vaisheshika Sutra. Control of this energy essentially controls the entire cosmos. The force in between the intergalactic space is the force of Bhaga, which controls every galaxy. When we see the cosmological constant, which is representing why the galaxies are holding together, why they are not running away. They should have been spreading more, but they are not spreading more. So scientists feel the cosmological constant, why it is so different than the calculated or predicted constant, why there is difference. The difference is because every galaxy is supposed to be having a different gravity, which we want to express in modern days terms, because the resultant of these three forces, Bhaga, Savita and Usha, will be different for every planet. Why gravity is so weak? The answer may lie in very nature of space-time. This solution that scientists are thinking, that Higgs boson, one of the bosons may be responsible for interactions for the gravity force. Now coming to the third misnomer. Are the black holes, or are they dark stars or black suns? The first real evidence for dark matter came in 1933 when it was detected, as I covered you, cosmological constant. And the scientists thought there must be some matter which is creating this force. So this matter was unseen. So he said it is Dunkel Materie in German, or it is dark matter. And whereas you all know that matter can only be, it could be invisible only if it does not interact with light in terms of emission, reflection or refraction, etc. The photons hold zero mass, and anything that holds zero mass, less than zero, would not qualify as a matter in classical sense. So dark matter is a substance. I agree, it must be there. But it is a substance which is, which I say as pre-matter, which helps in forming the matter. You are all aware that scientists agree today, only 4.6% of universe which is there, it is visible. Rest is either dark energy or dark matter. But 4.6% is very less, you must be feeling. But you can see so many stars, so many galaxies beyond imagination. And in this visible universe also, what we feel, the matter part of the universe, 4.6 part of the universe, it contains maximum abundant element, which is hydrogen, 73% to 74%. And it is followed by helium, which is 23% and 25%, and oxygen, carbon, neon, iron and nitrogen, and all other everything, iron, nickel, silicon, everything is exactly 0.5% of the total cosmos. So you will wonder, since all the stars are burning hydrogen, they are fusing it to make helium. So hydrogen must be must be burning and it should be ending now, and a percentage of hydrogen should now reduce. But it is not happening because hydrogen is also forming up continuously. Hydrogen is the first stable element. It is fuel for the stars. But when you see how the stars convert hydrogen into helium, they are doing it not only for hydrogen, they are also doing fusion for the helium into lithium, lithium into beryllium, and into heavy metals. Those interactions are actually taking place much deeper inside, whereas the lighter interactions of lighter elements are taking place on surface. So if you see what is the purpose of the star, the purpose of the star in this cosmos is to create matter. So they are creating matter, they are transforming lighter elements into heavier elements. And when the star is heavy and it has got sufficient matter, heavy matter can contain inside it, due to revolutions it becomes unstable and it breaks away. So that's why how the solar systems originate after the star, the central star explodes or breaks away, and the heavier elements like they take place in the planets. Similarly, if we examine the pre-matter, which is neutron, electron, proton, other smaller particles inside the nucleus, and in the out of these, neutron have mean life of approximately 15 minutes. It is 881 seconds. The electron is very stable. It is very stable, and it is about 66,000 yota years, so 10^28 years. It is, its life is as it is meant, been made for a long time. The atoms are thereafter very, very stable elements. The life of proton is 16.7 billion yota years, means it is even more. So the proton is the maximum stable particle, followed by electron and other neutrinos. Whereas the photons are also, they do not qualify as matter, but they are made for forever. As Rishi Kanad said, at one moment comes when the rays, the kiran, they are made forever in space and time. So this is the secret of the unlimited energy of the universe. It lies in the unlimitedness or infinity of the space and time of the waves. They are continuous forever in space and time. Also, I will cover, I read a book in which Vasishtha Muni, he teaches Ram, and this excellent book is called Yoga Vasishtha. He tells Rama how this universe came into being, and he tells there are structures such as pat, like you see patsan or pat, which is known as vastra, like threads are woven in like space-time continuum, it becomes a fabric. And then there are 3D fabrics, which is known as ghata. Ghata is a spherical structure like ghada or a pot. It is a spherical structure. And a kund, which is a ku-anda, means it is a bad egg. Spherical structure, but without a bottom. So there are many structures like this, they exist when the waves interact with each other. Now coming to another very interesting thought. If you see an atom and you see the ratio of where the electrons orbit and where the size of the nucleus, if you blow up the size of nucleus, like size of a cricket ball or of a apple, then you will find the distance between the nearest electron orbit and the nucleus is approximately 3 kilometers. That means how much weight can you hold in your arms when you are picking up so many balloons? So in case you have to hold a lot of weight, when you have to pack a lot of weight, like the kind of weight and mass which is packed inside the black holes, you do not need orbiting electrons. They have to be done away with. So that we reach a conclusion that black holes are only formed with something which is like solid nuclei are holding together. And when these nuclei are together, they are so strongly clubbed with each other and they exert a very strong gravity or very strong force on the surrounding. They can suck up all the photons and they can create a new particle. And in all likelihood, these dark stars or the black holes, which we now call them, are actually having a purpose. The purpose is to create pre-matter. And when the pre-matter comes out, they are the pre-matter protons, neutrons, and all these pre-matter particles are thrown out and they catch on with the electrons. And electrons are free neutrinos. They are produced freely inside the vast open space. So they catch on and they form the first element, which is hydrogen. This hydrogen is sucked up by the stars and being formed into the heavy matter. So from the waves, how the waves interact with each other, and they form the pre-matter, and pre-matter forms the matter. There is a step-by-step process which has been described in Rig Veda. It has been described in Vaisheshika Sutra. It has been described by Vasishtha Muni in Yoga Vasishtha. So these dark stars, as you are now aware, there are input and output mechanisms, which is known as accretion disk, and how they interact. The galaxies have originated from the central black holes, which may act in cycles of expansions and contraction over huge time scales. The black holes also exert force which are natural, but may also contain intelligent control mechanisms. And scientists are able to realize this. They are able to see the coherence between one galaxy and another, kind of form of communication which takes place between the satellites of Jupiter, between Sun and Jupiter. Some of this communication has been captured. And recently, there was a news, you can search for this on the internet. Black holes may hold more power than we imagine. They dictate which stars will be born or not. So this is a published article. This is not by me. So they are an intelligent control mechanism of this entire Milky Way or entire individual galaxies. As Einstein said, and I quote, "There is a perfect brain behind all the natural physical laws," unquote.
Yeah, Malik ji, pranam. What about multiverse? It's just another universe or another galaxy, he asks.
Yes, as per my interpretation, it is another galaxy.
Multiverse isn't many universes together making a multiverse?
Ma'am, it is a figment of imagination when people think there are many universe exist simultaneously. Whereas if you see the design of the universe is very simple. Very simple. Because beauty lies in simplicity and symmetry, and there are principles of beauty. And these principles of beauty are there in the perfect design of the universe. How from Anutva means smallest, subtle of the subtle, it grows from Mahatva, big and bigger. So it is known as principle of Mahat. The entire thing has been understood quite well in our scriptures. If you think about parallel universes, you think about parallel universes in space, like one galaxy is as good as one universe, and another galaxy is another universe, and they are disconnected with each other we will not be able to even transcend our galaxy and go to the space between one galaxy and another galaxy, even if we move with the speed of light. I can read your question. What determines the speed of time? Light.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Speed of light is determined by the object which is able to travel at this. Firstly, we must understand, actually, when you start the universe, when the universe is started, it is started as force of will. Anna? Pranav. Pran. Pran comes like will. If you take a pran, you have a strong will. And pranav shabd means it is also sound of om. Like when you will be chanting om in not om, but this sound which will be there. This is the equivalent sound of that particular initial vibration, which is thought vibration. And if you know, if you understand thought vibration, it will be instantaneous. It will be like quantum communication. Like when you think here and you pray to Shiva, and if Shiva is listening to you, wherever he is, his seat is center of cosmos. So wherever he is, and he will be instantly able to listen to you. But as these thought waves interact with each other and make patterns, make beat patterns, there will be compressions and rarefications, and then there will be more interactions, and then there will be interactions which are forming this ghat pat kund like structures, and then they are forming the stable structures in like that in a ghat word, by the way, ghat ghatna ghatta hai, jo ghat gaya means which is become stable. So so these are all thought waves of the Shivalinga, which they move around the cosmos, and they now form up as the energy and the matter and all these things. So time is it is a fabric of space and time. What happens is time gets condensed in the closeness the galactic centers. If you spend a minute near to the central black hole, near, I'm not saying on or inside it, near the central black hole, it will be like thousands of years on Earth. So that's why it is said Brahma's one day is one kalpa, and one kalpa is like millions or billions of years here on Earth. So when scientists say the universe is only 14 billion years old, so I ask them, how do you decide, like what time speed you have taken? Have you taken the linear time scale, like what we observe today, or have you taken the time scale when we were not there? The Earth was not formed. This time scale was not there when the central black hole, the Sagittarius A star, was exploding itself. The time was infinite at inside the black hole. So when it start forming, so every moment, every second is like millions of years. So that's why we say the galaxy, even the Milky Way galaxy, is many trillions of years. It has been calculated. It is how much is the length of a kalpa, which is Brahma's one day.
Last 3 months before only, I given my examination on the Arva Vigyan, Arvachin Vigyan. That is a subject which is given in my Siddhan Jyotish, and I just completed 3 days before. Okay. My Hindu astronomy. So I just want to ask you that there are the words like the Niharika for the nebula. Okay. And there's a Sarpya Akarya Akashganga. There are the many Akashgangas are there.
Yes.
Even they are giving these names.
Okay.
When we are reading this, our Hindu astronomy.
Yes.
So still after the launch of the James Webb telescope, now yes. the new pictures we are getting in that. So my question is regarding that now they are showing that the what are the pictures we are getting it about the time where the birth of the universe taken place.
Yes.
So according to our own theology of the Bhagavad Gita and all the Vedas, what do you think that this is the original pictures or it's a of which time?
Yeah. It's a very interesting question. Very interesting question. You see, the farthest galaxy which they will see, which is the farthest, say universe is 14 billion years old, as they say. So if they say any galaxy which is 14 billion light years away, so that means they are seeing the first galaxies, one of the first galaxies, because that light is reaching us. So it is the birth of the universe as per them. But when you see that galaxy was there at that moment, 14 billion years ago. That light is reaching us now. So even if you say any particular star in our own galaxy, which is say one light year away, so the position of that star was 1 year back. That position was 1 year back. The current position, we do not know which side it has moved. So obviously we can calculate, guess and calculate. But their entire concept is incorrect because they believe in Big Bang, which is a stolen concept. And they think that Big Bang is the birth of the entire cosmos. It is not. Because when they say this Big Bang, which was a very compressed ball of matter and which has exploded itself and created time, space and everything, where did this matter came from? And if you say at time t equal to 0, this took place. So what happened at t equal to minus 1? So what was this matter before? So this I call as scientific mythology. When they call Hindu mythology, like whatever we tell them, they call Hindu mythology, which is very scientific. And they call it something they create. Okay, time got created somehow. So this is scientific mythology. They are unable to explain this. So Indian darshan, jyotish, everything that explains it very clearly. And you don't need to fill books, because anumiti is quality of soul, means your intellectual complex has got power to reduce volumes of information into small principles, what Rishi Kanad has done for us.